Good morning. My name is Debbie Hasdorf, and I'm the pastor here at Parkview United Church of Christ in White Bear Lake, Minnesota. Whoever you are, wherever you're on life's journey, you are welcome here. Today is our first Sunday of the new year, and it's so good to be together. I hope you all had a good Christmas season and you were able to see family either in person or virtually. And your church family is here too. And we have missed you. We wished we could be together. And we have hope in the new year that because of our vaccines that we will once again be able to gather together at church. So I hope you hope too. Now let us begin. We're going to begin with an opening prayer, and this prayer was written by Walter Brueggemann, who is an Old Testament scholar in the United Church of Christ, and it's called In Violence and Travail. O God, we give you thanks for the babe born in violence. We give you thanks for the miracle of Bethlehem, born into the Jerusalem heritage. We do not understand why the innocents must be slaughtered. We know that your kingdom comes in violence and travail. Our time would be a good time for your kingdom to come because we have had enough of violence and travail. So we wait with eager longing and with enormous fear because your promises do not coincide with our favorite injustices. We pray for the coming of your kingdom on earth as it is around your heavenly throne. We are people grown weary of waiting. We dwell in the midst of cynical people and we have settled for what we can control. We do know that you hold initiative for our lives, that your love planned our salvation before we saw the light of day. And so we wait for your coming in your vulnerable baby in whom all things are made new. Amen. And now we're going to begin with favorite hymn for the Sunday after Christmas, We Three Kings of Orient Are. And Heather's going to lead us in singing. Heather?
Oh, Carols sing we know of Christmas, Noel sing we hear.
Hear our grateful praises to the babe so dear.
Sing we Noel, the King is born Noel. Sing we know of Christmas, sing we know Noel.
From the eastern country came the kings afar. Bearing gifts to Bethlehem, guided by a star.
Sing we Noel, the King is born Noel. Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now Noel. Noel, Noel, Noel. Born is the King, King of Israel.
This star.
Our scripture lesson today is from the book of Matthew, the second chapter, the first through the 12th verses, and I'm going to be reading from Eugene Peterson's paraphrase, The Message. It's called Scholars from the East. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem village, Judah territory, this was during Herod's kingship, a band of scholars arrived in Jerusalem from the east. They asked around, "Where can we find and pay homage to the newborn king of the Jews? We observed a star in the eastern sky that signaled his birth. We're on pilgrimage to worship him." When word of their inquiry got to Herod, he was terrified, and not Herod alone, but most of Jerusalem as well. Herod lost no time. He gathered all the high priests and religious scholars in the city together and asked, "Where is the Messiah supposed to be born?" They told him, "Bethlehem, Judah territory." The prophet Micah wrote it plainly. "It's you, Bethlehem, in Judah's land, no longer bringing up the rear. From you will come the leader who will shepherd rule my people, my Israel." Herod then arranged a secret meeting with the scholars from the east. Pretending to be as devout as they were, he got them to tell them exactly when the birth announcement star appeared. Then he told them the prophecy about Bethlehem and said, "Go find this child. Leave no stone unturned. As soon as you find him, send word and I'll join you at once to worship." Instructed by the king, they set off. Then the star appeared again, the same star they had seen in the eastern skies. It led them on until it hovered over the place of the child. They could hardly contain themselves. They were in the right place. They had arrived at the right time. They entered the house and saw the child in the arms of Mary, his mother. Overcome, they kneeled and worshiped him. Then they opened their luggage and presented gifts, gold, frankincense, myrrh. In a dream, they were warned not to report back to Herod. So they worked out another route, left the territory without being seen, and returned to their own country. 5 years ago, when I first preached on this text, or I last preached on this text, there was a song that was going through my brain as I was writing the sermon. It's called, I Still Haven't Got What I'm Looking For. I still haven't got what I'm looking for from YouTube. It goes like this. I have climbed the highest mountain. I have run through the fields only to be with you, only to be with you. I have run, I have crawled, I have scaled the city walls only to be with you. But I still haven't found what I'm looking for. But I still haven't found what I'm looking for. Do you think the wise men got what they were looking for? Did you ever think about what must have happened to those wise men when they got back home? Did they live happily ever after? Were their lives changed? After the shimmering stars' light and the wonder and mystery of having now at last found their heart's desire, after all that, did it make a difference? Back home on a mundane Monday morning, taking out the garbage, changing diapers, balancing the checkbook, paying the bills, attending the meetings, and driving carpool, figuring out taxes and calling on clients and getting their teeth fixed and planning the birthday party and all the other 1,001 things that it takes to make a life. After all, these wise men had followed a star and they had been filled with joy at the journey's end. But was it really the journey's end when they returned to their own country? They didn't remain in the royal beauty bright of the star. But having been warned about Herod's deadly intentions, they returned to their home by another way. But what was life like? What was life like for them afterwards? After the star in the cold light of the day, how had it ever really mattered? Had they found what they were looking for? Do we ever truly find what it is we're looking for? We'd like to think that we can find the answers to our questions, that we can make peace in our lives, that we can climb to the peaks of life and see across the mountains and the valleys and find ourselves filled with understanding and fulfillment. We want to believe that like these three wise men, we can find purpose in our life. We can reach deep within ourselves and find the courage and strength to live a life of meaning and purpose and integrity. We want to believe that we can follow that man that the baby became, and we can work like him for peace and justice. We can love our neighbors as he taught us, and we can be filled with compassion and live in kindness as he taught us to do. We want to finish our lives knowing that we have lived well, that we have worked well, and that we have loved well. But we do well to remember that the next day, the day after they finished their journey, they followed their star and found their baby and gave their gifts, the Magi got up the next morning and found themselves not in a state of bliss, but being pursued by Herod's and afraid for their lives and convinced that the life of the child that they had come to believe was the hope for the world was threatened by the powers of violence and hate. You see, every day that we wake up and discover that we are alive, we begin again. There is little rest for the weary. God always asks more of us. As long as we live and we breathe, we are never done. This week I've been reading a book called Love's Executioner. It's written by a man named Irvin Yalom, a PhD psychologist from Stanford. And it's about Dr. Yalom's practice of psychotherapy and his teachings around the meaning of the human psyche. The way he begins his book really impressed me. He describes an experiment that he's done, or a process that he's gone through year after year with people in his school. And he describes 300 or 400 people, strangers to each other, who are told to pair up with another person and to ask the other person a question. And the question is, what do you want? What do you want? Dr. Yalop writes, "Could anything be simpler? One innocent question and its answer. And yet time after time, I have seen this group exercise evoke unexpectedly powerful feelings. He characterizes the answers to this question in four categories. The first of all is the questions concerning the inevitability of death for each of us and for our loved ones. Questions about, will I suffer? Will I lose someone I love? Questions about the freedom we experience or we don't experience to make our lives what we really want them to be. Why do I have what I have? Have I earned what I have? Do I deserve what I have? Is what I have enough? Questions about our ultimate aloneness. Am I lovable and am I loved? And our desire for true intimacy. And finally, the questions about our desire to make meaning and sense from life. The big why. Why are things the way they are? Why do bad things happen to good people? Why do some people have so much and so some other people have so little? There are lots and lots of these big, big questions. They're questions that most of us will never find the answers to, no matter how hard we strive through our lives. We still won't have found what it is we're looking for. What do you want? It seems like such a selfish question, and yet the very selfishness of the question gets to the heart of what it is we do here Sunday after Sunday. We ask some hard questions. What kind of person do you want to be? What kind of life do you want to live? What kind of a world do you want to live in? How do you want to be remembered? How will your life matter? Those are some of the biggest questions too. The poet Mary Oliver asks, tell me, what is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life? The wise men thought that they were on a search for the penultimate moment of their lives. Their talents, their expertise, their wealth, their intellect had all been well used in finding this Christ child. They had followed the star. They had found the child. They had given the gifts. They had taken the first steps towards recognizing this child who represented God's plan for the redemption of humankind. And yet, the next morning, they awoke to a day in which they had lost purpose and meaning. What were they to do next? Were they to return home? Were they to return back to give Herod the news that he wanted? How were they to make sense of this strange and eerie request that had come from Herod? What would they do next, since the mission of their journey had been fulfilled? The beginning of a new year is a good opportunity to stand where those wise men stood. To look at our lives not only with questions about how we should change our lives or how we can resolve to be different. Diets, exercise plans, budgets, priorities. Those questions are really small in the bigger scheme of things. The new year asks us to reflect with the wise men about how our lives have been changed this year. What dreams have been fulfilled? What work has been completed? How are we different as we stand on the precipice of a new year? We've been taught somehow to think about our lives in a linear way. Childhood, adolescence, young adulthood, education, career, marriage, family, children at home, children flying from the nest, weddings, grandchildren, first job, next job, better job, promotion, 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 retirement, sunbird, senior living. But perhaps a better image for the seasons of life might be a double helix, swirling around and yet upward, looping both around and upward. At so many points in life, we finish a project or a life stage, or a life stage finishes with us. Our work ebbs and flows, our marriages change or end, our children grow and separate, we lose friends and we make friends. But this year I think we have to ask ourselves some different questions. This year, like perhaps no other year in my lifetime, this year has taught us both how strong we are and how vulnerable we are. 2020 has opened our eyes to the cracks in the life that we've been living. It has revealed to us the state of our union. There are a lot of things that we took for granted that we've had to look at again this year. This idea of bipartisanship, I grew up with that. It doesn't seem to be working right now. Sacrifice for one's country. I remember Dan Johnson saying that going to war was believing that there were some things that were worth giving your life for. Sacrificing for one's neighbor, for one's country, for what is right. We took for granted the way that people shared a respect for science, and we all held on to the validity of the work of the scientists and the doctors and the people who were exploring the universe. Science could be quantified and could be believed. We took for granted the idea of fair, balanced, investigative journalism and what it meant to having a democracy. We took for granted respect for the truth and rejection of lying. We took for granted our understanding of democracy, the value of democracy, and the way that our Constitution was written to protect democracy. We took for granted that religion was a force for compassion and for justice for the weakest members of our society, that religion was supposed to lead us in taking care of the poor and the downtrodden. We took for granted that religion was to help us to believe in a power higher than profit or influence, and higher than winning. All these, we took for granted that everyone believed that all people are created equal, endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights, amongst those life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. This was one of the biggest cracks this year when we came to believe that, we came to understand that not everyone shared those values, that we'd been taught history in a way that didn't allow us to see the cracks, the ways in which some people were allowed to pursue life, liberty, and happiness, and other people had huge impediments. The inequalities of our land of opportunity. We found the cracks this year that without strong leadership, liberty cannot be exercised without responsibility or accountability. This whole thing about masks just to me revealed some deep cracks in who we are. And we took for granted this idea that modern medicine had protected us, that it could protect us from all the threats that came to us through our medical systems. We have this new public health crisis that has arisen that has suddenly become beyond our control. And 346,000 people in our country alone have died from the coronavirus. We have learned a lot this year about what it is we don't know. We've learned a lot about where the cracks are, where the problems are, where the pits are in the life and the world and the country that we thought we knew, and even in the churches and the faith that we thought we knew. So we've learned a lot about that question. I still haven't found what I'm looking for. That was the question of the three wise men. And in addition to that question, I think we have another question to answer, and that comes from another great source of wisdom. It comes from the wisdom of Mick Jagger and Keith Richards. And the question this year is, what if you didn't get what you wanted, what did you get that you needed? What did you get that you needed? You know the song from Mick Jagger, "You may not always get what you want. You may not always get what you want. You may not always get what you want, but you get what you need." Did we get something that we needed out of this horrible, difficult year? I don't believe that God made this happen, but I do believe that God has been working through this to build a new life, a new way of being, a different way of being. God is bringing God's kingdom to life here on earth. And we need to ask how it is that what we had didn't work and how we can make it into something new. What did you get this year that you needed, that you didn't maybe even know that you needed? That it took a pandemic and a racial reckoning and a horrible, horrible division within our country to show us, to show you what it is that you really need. I found out some things that I really needed this year. I needed time with my children. I hadn't had uninterrupted time with my adult children in years, and this pandemic has given that to me. I found new challenges at my work. I found deeper connections with the people in my church that I work with. I've learned to sacrifice and how good it feels to do something for someone else. I've learned about essential workers like the people who work in the convenience stores and the grocery stores, the people who plow our roads, the people who keep our electrical system going, our doctors, our nurses. It goes on and on and on. I've learned how everyone is an important part of keeping life going. Sometimes you don't get what you want. None of us wanted to live this way this year, but we can find something that we always needed and maybe didn't even know we needed in what has happened this year. Perhaps those three wise men, when they came back, found out that they hadn't got everything they wanted, but they had gotten something new that they needed. I want to finish today with a video, a beautiful video from NPR, National Public Radio. And it sort of speaks to one of the cracks that we found this year, and that's the crack of racism. We had what I would call a racial reckoning, beginning right here in Minneapolis with the death of George Floyd. And this video is a beautiful, beautiful rendition of Auld Lang Syne. And it's sung by a black choir in what used to be a white church, where the deacons would not allow black people to come in and to sit and to worship. And so here is this beautiful black choir filling this sanctuary full of beautiful music, remembering all the lives that have been given up, all the lives that have been changed, all the lives that have been stomped down by racism and by all the dark sins of our souls. So I really encourage you to watch this. I just found it to be beautiful, and I hope you will find a way to think about how we have had what we've had, why we've had things the way they have been, and how they might be different. Amen. This is the first Sunday of a new year, and we begin the new year again with joy in our heart and with concerns on our heart. People that we love and care about who are experiencing illness or loss or suffering of some kind. And also people in our lives who have been deeply blessed, whose lives have been filled with joy, people who have experienced healing and hope. And we wrap all this up into prayer and we send it off into the air, believing that God hears our prayers and believing that our prayers connect us through an invisible web of love. So, today we have some prayer concerns. The first prayer concern is for the family of Johnny Jones. Some of you may not have heard yet, but Johnny passed away a week ago, Sunday, and his service was here in the sanctuary on Wednesday. And it was a beautiful, very small family service, and we remembered his life and remembered it well. And his wife, Jane, was present, and all of his kids and his grandkids, and it was really good to be together. So I want to pray for a prayer of thanksgiving that we know that Johnny is beyond pain and suffering, and he is securely in the arms of God. And I also want to give thanks for his life and for all the lives that he touched and for the gift that he was to so many people. So a prayer of thanksgiving for the life of Johnny Jones. And that's also a prayer of concern and love for his family, who have been through a very hard week, who have experienced a devastating loss, and who are today beginning to put their lives back together again in a new way, and in a way that they never wanted, but in a way that God is present. God is working through them to bring forth new life. So for Johnny's family, we ask you to hold them in your loving arms, O God, and we hold them in our prayers. For Jane and Johnny and the family, we hold you in the light of Christ. And then Dwayne Owen sent a message. He said that his brother-in-law, Tony Good, has tested positive for COVID and that he has multiple health issues. And so he would like him to be lifted up in prayer. So we lift up Tony, we lift up Dwayne, and we lift up all the people who have loved ones who are suffering from COVID. And we pray that God will give them hope and God will give them faith and God will give them a way of letting that person know how much they are loved. So for Tony and Dwayne and for all those people who have loved ones with COVID, we hold you in the light of Christ. And then we received a phone call this week from Sue Howard, who is Joanne Williams' daughter. And she let us know that Joanne had had COVID earlier this year and that she had recuperated from it. She had it in December, she said. So she's on her way to recovery. She's with her daughter, and we miss her here terribly. So for Joanne, as she recovers from COVID, we give thanks for her recovery. We hold you in the light of Christ. And then Earl and Mary Larson have a daughter whose name is Rachel. And she's been struggling with colon cancer and got some difficult news this week and is changing direction with her treatment and is entering a new part of her cancer journey. And her family is very concerned. Her parents are concerned and live very far away. So we pray for Rachel, we pray for her kids and her family. We pray for Earl and Mary, for us, knowing how hard it is to have a child who's sick and to not be able to be there. So for Earl and Mary and for Rachel and all her family and all the people who love her, we hold you in the light of Christ. And finally, I want to light a prayer. A prayer for all of us and the ways in which we are broken open by racism. We had another police killing this week of an African-American person, and I don't know, none of us know what happened or what is right or what is wrong. All we know is that once again there's been a problem between our police and our the people of color in our community. And it just reminds us that is a wound that has not healed. It is a wound in which we participate, and we ask that God open our eyes and open our hearts that we might find a way to respond and a way to be agents of healing and reconciliation. So for all of us, as we seek to heal the deep wound that is racism, we hold you in the light of Christ. Let us pray. Loving God, we just haven't got what we're looking for. And sometimes we don't get what we want, we only get what we need. But we trust that we cannot see the big picture, that sometimes we don't know the difference between what we want and what we need. Remind us, O God, that you are a bigger power, that you have a wider vision, that we are a part of the healing of the world, that we are the part of the reconciliation of your people, that we are a part of your love made real. As we go into this new year, O God, help us to deepen our faith, to listen more closely to our hearts, to seek to connect with you through prayer and study. Guide us as we seek ways to be agents, hands-on agents of your love for people around us who need to know your peace and your hope and your faith and your love. And we pray all this in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
feeling valley low. I can be a streetlight, showing you the way home. If you can hold my hand when you need to let.
It is good that this first Sunday of a new year, we are at the communion table once again. I'd like to say that Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, and every letter in between. We come to the table recognizing that like the bread, we are broken, and we need God's healing and God's presence in our lives. As we move forward into the new year, we take our brokenness with us, and we ask that God be present. And then we drink from the cup, and the cup is a cup of hope, a cup of love, a cup of reconciliation. The cup is our hope that in the new year, our wounds can be healed, our relationships can be made new, that our world can become a better place, and that we can become a part of that reconciliation. So when we come to the table today, we come not to be fed, but to feed. We come not to receive peace, but to be also to be an agent of peace. We come not only to be loved, but also to learn how to love other people. This is how we begin the year at the table of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. God of all time, help us to enter the new year quietly, thoughtful of who we are to ourselves and others, mindful that our steps can make an impact and our words carry power. May we walk gently. May we speak only after we have listened well. Creator of all life, help us to enter the new year reverently, aware that you have endowed every creature and plant, every person and habitat with beauty and purpose. May we regard the world with tenderness. May we honor rather than destroy. Lover of all souls, help us enter the new year joyfully, willing to laugh and dance and dream, remembering our many gifts with thanks and looking forward to blessings yet to come. May we welcome your lavish love. May we cast off the small, vindictive God our fears have made. May the grace and peace of Christ bless us now and in the days ahead. Amen. On the night when he was betrayed, after the meal was over, Jesus took some of the bread that was left over after the meal, and he broke it, saying, "This is my body broken for you." And then in like manner, he took some of the wine that was left over after the meal, and he blessed it, and he gave thanks for it, and he poured it, saying, "This is my blood shed for the forgiveness of your sin." Ministering in Christ's name, we share with you the bread and the cup. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, as we go out from here into our lives, into a new year, help us to find your presence in our hearts. Help us to see through your eyes. Help us to hear through your ears. Help us to show compassion through your hands. Guide us that the year ahead might be a year where we get some of what we want and find some of what we need, but do it all in your name and for someone else. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And that's the end of our service today. I'm glad that you were with us here today. I invite you to come and join us again next week. We'll be here for a while until we can be together again. So now for the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and make God's face to shine upon you, and be gracious unto you, and grant you God's peace. Amen.